Let's all give a hand, it's like Diane Thompson.
So first of all, it's such, thank you, such a privilege being here with you this morning. I consider sharing health information that can change your lives a mission of mine. So I really see this as a pleasure and a privilege. Now, as mentioned, I work at New York Presbyterian, Columbia Presbyterian, and New York Presbyterian Hospital has been number one in New York for the past 6 years. And what happens is you have people then come from all over the world to that hospital. So we have top CEO, top world leaders, we have millionaires, people with lots of letters after their names, and then we have the average folk who live in the community. The one thing that they all share with me when they get to my rehabilitation unit is that they wish, oh, they wish they had spent more time taking care of their greatest wealth, which is their health. Because no amount of rehabilitation is as good as never having the disease to begin with. And so I hope to share with you some things today that's going to help to prevent you from having some of those common illnesses. I'm actually going to zone in a little bit on our fifth leading killer. And I'll do that because we seem to be affected by it more so than any other group. And I'm hoping that what I share with you today, if you implement even one or two of these things, you will actually drastically reduce your risk of getting a stroke. Another thing you should know is that in our community, we have stroke, we're at higher risk of having strokes. Not only that, it occurs to us at an earlier age, and when we get it, the symptoms are more severe. The disability is more severe. So the most important thing you can do is to prevent this. So just so we're all on the same page, I'll briefly just go over what a stroke is. Basically, the blood supply is not getting to a portion of the brain. So it happens either because the blood vessel is blocked, could be because of a clot, it's stenosis, there are plaques, but the blood supply doesn't get to a portion of the brain. The other reason is the blood vessel bursts and also the blood supply doesn't get to a part of the brain. When blood doesn't get to a part of the brain, it dies. It doesn't get the oxygen, the nutrients, the glucose is gonna die. Remember, your brain controls your movement, your ability to think, to talk, to walk. And if that part of the brain is affected, then you'll see those disabilities. The other thing is to recognize the signs and symptoms of a stroke. And this is really quick. And when I tell you this, and this may be just reinforcement or reminder for some of you, you need to share this with other people around you when you leave here, because they may be the ones that have to save your life. So you may know it, you want them to know it as well. The acronym is FAST, F-A-S-T. And the F is for facial droop. The A is for arm weakness. So if you tell the person, lift the arm, and one goes up and the other doesn't. And the S is for speech, slurred speech, or maybe the speech is just confusing. Or maybe you're speaking to them and they're not understanding what you're saying. If you notice any one of these, or any combination of these, acutely, meaning the person was fine one moment and then the next moment they're having these symptoms, there's a 72% chance they're having a stroke. And the T in FAST is time. It's of the essence. I can't tell you how many people have experienced these symptoms. They show up the next day. And they'll say to me, you know, Dr. Thompson, I knew it was a stroke. I just decided to stay home and see what happened. Not the way to do it. There are potential treatments that could reverse some of your disabilities, some of your symptoms, but you gotta get to the hospital within a certain period of time. The window is about 3 hours. There's some hospitals that are working with 4.5 hours. If you don't get there in time, you don't get that treatment, and you could have potentially gotten better, but you don't. And the other thing is, a stroke is an emergency. You don't stay home and see what happens. Just like a heart attack is an emergency, a stroke or brain attack is an emergency. So please call 911. Don't drive yourself to the hospital. People have done that too. And don't get a friend to drive you. Call 911. They can start to treat you in the EMS. They call ahead. They clear the CAT scan. There's a lot going on behind the scenes that you don't know about. So recognize those signs. Tell that to someone else, because that person may save you. So you want them to know it. But the most important thing I want to talk about today is prevention. Because this is where we have the biggest bang for our buck. As is often said, an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. And I've seen people on my rehab unit, they do very well, but every one of them will tell you, no amount of rehab is as good as never having a stroke to begin with. So the first thing is, I want you guys to get a primary care doctor. This person is on your team. They're going to help you to stay well. The game today is to stay well, okay? Not to necessarily get better after you have the thing. We want to stay well. So get a primary care doctor. If you don't have one, if you're in the New York area and you don't have one, you don't know one, don't hesitate to contact me. I'm actually going to leave some of my pens with my contact information where folks are going to get blood pressure checked today. So that's another reason that you should go get your blood pressure checked today, right? So I'm going to leave those pens there with my contact information. If you need a primary care doctor, I can give you a list of good people. So get a primary care doctor. And by the way, you don't want to wait until the midst of crisis to be finding someone. You want someone you know, you have a relationship with them. They know you, they understand you. The second thing is to get an annual checkup. I'm always amazed by this. Most people who have a car, they get their oil checked, the engine checked. Right? If you have a boiler, the boiler gets serviced at a certain time of the year. But our greatest health, or our greatest wealth, our health, our temple, we don't do the same thing. Please get an annual checkup. The year just started, so if you haven't scheduled one, go do that when you leave here. There is a saying that if the train is going to hit you, you want to know so you can get out of the way. So go get your checkup so you can figure out what's going on with you before it becomes a major problem. The other thing is, when you go get the checkup, know your numbers. You want to know if you have high blood pressure. How are you going to fix it if you don't know you have it? There are many people walking around with high blood pressure, and the first time they know is when they have a stroke. Go get your numbers. Know your lipids, your cholesterol. Do you have high cholesterol? Because then you'll know how to fix it. Know your BMI. Your BMI is your body mass index. A lot of us are walking around with a little bit of extra weight. I'm not talking to anybody in here, but people you know. A little bit of extra weight. And did you know that as little as 5 to 10 pounds can make a huge difference in your blood pressure and all your cardiovascular risk? So go and get your BMI, see where you are and what you need to do. Learn about your glucose level. Better yet, ask your doctor to check your hemoglobin A1C, because that tells your glucose level over about a 12-week period. And you know whether or not you're diabetic or pre-diabetic. There are millions of people walking around pre-diabetic. And you can actually turn that around. I can tell you from personal experience, there was a time a couple of years ago where I was slacking off. And when I went for my checkup, I realized I was pre-diabetic. I know that, as there's a saying that goes, our genetics load the gun, but our lifestyle is what pulls the trigger. So I know that diabetes runs in my family, but I decided it was going to run past me. So the moment I found out that I was pre-diabetic, I was going to fix that right away. When I returned to my primary care doctor, he was very impressed that the numbers were so much better, and they will not go back to the pre-diabetic levels. So please know your numbers. The next thing is, if you smoke, if you are within my voice, and you're currently smoking, and this is coming from a place of love, stop it. Stop it. There is nothing good that can come from smoking. Smoking is bad for your health. It puts you at risk for multiple cancers, multiple pulmonary disorders, cardiovascular disease. You are sucking up carbon monoxide when you smoke. There's nothing good that comes from it. I know it's difficult. My dad was a chain smoker. He died still a smoker. My mom quit 10 years ago. So I know that it's difficult, but it's doable. And that's why you're gonna work with your primary care doctor, because there's so many resources out there to help you stop smoking. So please stop smoking. It's one of the best things you can do for your health. It reduces your risk of stroke. So if you're sitting in here as a smoker, know that you have our support and we want the best for you, so please stop. The other thing was mentioned earlier, blood pressure. In our community, a lot of people walk around with high blood pressure. It's a big risk factor for stroke and many other diseases. High blood pressure, by the way, is called the silent killer, because a lot of times you don't know it's a problem until it's a problem. I'll tell you this briefly. When I was doing my training, I met this young African-American woman. She was an editor for a magazine. And I met her at the rehab unit. She had a wonderful life, had been jet-setting all over the world, hobnobbing with celebrities and the wealthy folks, stayed in wonderful hotels, ate wonderful food at expensive restaurants. And she had a stroke, and in an instant, her life changed. When I met her, she was in the rehab unit, sitting in a wheelchair, paralyzed on one side of her body. That wonderful job she had was no more. In fact, just basic things, dressing, going to the bathroom, she needed help for those. And so, one thing she confided to me, she said, you know, I knew I had high blood pressure. My doctor told me, but I took the pills, it sent me to the bathroom a lot. You know, I had to urinate a lot, and I decided I didn't want to do that because it interrupted my job. Well, the job is no more. So if you have high blood pressure, so by the way, if you don't know you have it, remember we said you are going to get those checked. And today, they have blood pressure being checked. We can tell you where to go, and you can get your blood pressure checked. So there's no excuse. Please get it done. But if you have high blood pressure and you're put on medication, please take your medication. Don't stop taking your medication. Today we actually know you can use lifestyle modification and lower the blood pressure, but you need to do that with your doctor's help. Don't do it on your own and risk getting a stroke, because it changes everything. So take your blood pressure medicine and then implement the lifestyle stuff. Now, some of the lifestyle stuff that you could implement, and this is going to help you with just about every chronic illness. Number one is healthy nutrition. The big thing is a whole food, plant-based nutrition. If you focus on that, you are almost all the way home. So eating mostly plants, fruits, vegetables, that's the best thing for you. If you're still adding salt to your food, it's no longer in vogue. Stop that, okay? Don't add salt to your food. And actually, you'll be surprised. Your taste buds will get used to you not doing that. So don't add salt to your food. And stay away from salty foods. The bacon, hot dogs, the deli meats. By the way, in case you didn't know, on the WHO website, those things are listed as a group one carcinogen, just so you know. So stay away from those things as much as you can. The next thing is to avoid the fried foods. Listen, you can have fried chicken these days and or fried whatever, but you don't have to put it in oil. There are lots of ways to do it and still get that taste. Exercise is important. Get yourself active and moving. That's really important. And by the way, we never knew this was important before, but sleep. This is coming from someone who used to stay up all night and study and go straight to an exam. I know better now. 7 to 9 hours of sleep. sleep is important. And the final thing I'm gonna add is something that we see in the blue zone. So throughout this world, we have people who live the longest, healthiest lives. And one of the things that they found is they all have purpose, passion, a sense of mission. By the way, I'm getting that from you guys here today, so that's a good thing. It's called the ikigai. That's a Japanese word for that. When you have passion and purpose, you tend to take good care of yourselves. So please implement those things for a longer life. And again, remember, your genetics is what loads the gun. Your lifestyle is what pulls the trigger. You don't have to get these chronic diseases. So practice good lifestyles so we can keep you healthy. Thank you.